Warmest greetings to our YouTube audience and wherever this video is posted. Warmest greeting in this case is literal. We are recording this analysis from the beautiful Southern California. And for those of our colleagues who still think climate change is unreal, every summer it's getting warmer and warmer, and there's not even an ocean breeze right now. I live in a seaside town, and I've never seen it this hot. At any rate, this is just a little precursor. This analysis is a follow-up to an interview that I just gave to Iran's Press TV, one of the best media outlets in the world when it comes to alternative media. Those of you who are not familiar with my work, my name is Alexander Azadgan, senior geopolitical analyst with several Iranian think tanks, as well as a couple in Russia, and Press TV and global media, as well as a professor of strategic global management and international political economy. I specialize in international relations issues and geopolitical issues pertaining to West Asia, which is popularly known as Middle East, although that's a derogatory term. The correct term is West Asia, as well as Eurasia, North America, and Far East, East Asia, or as they call it, Far East. This analysis is very comprehensive. It focuses on a very specific story, which was the firing of Ezra Cohen Watnick, who was one of the senior advisors to President Trump, one of the 12 with the highest security clearances in this administration. He just got fired today by the new cadre of advisors that are coming into the White House. And this is very much related with the geopolitics of Eurasia and Middle East. I'll get into that a little bit later. So basically all this coup that we are seeing in the Trump administration, and we have never had an administration with such a high turnover, starting with the firing, or, well, yeah, we don't know if you should call it firing or you know, involuntary resignation or voluntary resignation of Trump's national security advisor right in the beginning, followed by many of advisors, including the press secretary of the White House. I mean, this is like unbelievable. We've never had an administration in contemporary history with such a high turnover rate, which is a symptom of a very anarchic and undisciplined administration, which is something we should not be surprised by. Mr. Trump was never about restoring order. He wanted to challenge this order, and as he put it, you know, empty the swamp. But many analysts, even senior analysts, my colleagues, you know, drank the Kool-Aid, and they thought, oh, this is the beginning of a new age in Washington, where the establishment is going to be sort of put aside or be put in the backseat. And many other senior analysts like myself actually forecasted exactly what's happening 6 months ago. I myself was in Iran on an academic mission for 3 months in two occasions, in the latter parts of 2016 and very early parts of 2017, and I spoke in front of many high-ranking, high-profile Iranian think tanks, and I forecasted this. This was not something difficult to forecast whatsoever, but unfortunately, a lot of our colleagues went ahead and, you know, drank the Kool-Aid, and I'm just going to drink some water here. It's not Kool-Aid. Although it would be nice if it was Kool-Aid. I need some sugar right now. And they, you know, the forecasts were incorrect. So, you know, this is what I'm going to go back to my earlier forecast, which was the total deep takeover, total takeover of the deep state. This, of course, started after 9/11 with a coup that was called George W. Bush coup. That was a coup d'etat. We have had three coup d'etats. In the 20th century, and in 2001, of course, with President Bush. Two of these internal coups, were completely negative. That was the assassination of President Kennedy in 1963. And then, it was not just President Kennedy, it was a cadre of amazing leaders. So, you know, in this case, civil rights leader. and political leaders, or both actually. 63 with the assassination of President Kennedy, and then we had the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X, and, you know, topped off by the assassination on Robert F. Kennedy, president's brother, in 1968. So that was one phase of a coup d'etat, which we call very obviously very, very negative. Then came the positive coup d'etat, which was the ousting of Richard Nixon, who was an autocrat, who was basically a crook. he verified his crookedness when he went in front of a camera and said, "I'm not a crook." That was just a political mistake that has never happened in this country. And of course, the third and the grand coup d'etat, perhaps it will go into history as one of the blackest marks in our history, was the contrived false flag operation of 9/11. My whole point is that after 9/11, the deep state, which is converged with mainstream media. Mainstream media is basically the entertainment division of the military-industrial complex. And the military-industrial complex is comprised of the deep state, intelligentsia, and then the deep state's crazy military spending. Crazy. $600 to $700 billion a year. More military spending than all other countries in the world combined. So this was the third major coup d'etat that changed human history as we know it in the very beginning of the 21st century. They wanted to do this. The think tank behind this whole thing was called Project for New American Century, short for PNAC. These were crazy clash of the civilization people, going back to Strauss from the University of Chicago, who went ahead and hypothesized or theorized there's going to be a clash of civilization, which is what they're doing, which is what they want to do, which is what they want to manifest. And neocons, they were basically crazy neocons. During those 8 years of George Bush, that's what we had. It was phase one. Phase two was under President Obama. It was a neocon, neo-lib, just as horrible. This is what we call the establishment, the liberal establishment, or the neoliberal establishment, just as awful. Perhaps even more awful, because they killed more people with drones, and Mr. Obama had his own kill list, and this is the guy who, after the first year, undeservingly got the Nobel Peace Prize. Go figure. Complete lunacy. And now we have phase three, which is the complete takeover of the deep state in intelligentsia, media. Those of you who watch the Crooked News Network, as I call it, or Cunning News Network, better known as CNN, total fake news. They have been on Mr. Trump's rear end the minute he was voted into office. Of course, they were totally silent, which was ridiculous. You call these people journalists? I'm sorry, they are the servants of the empire. They're what we call prostitutes. Prostitutes of the press? They're horrible. So they were totally silent. Of course, they were instructed to be silent so this guy could be installed, not elected, installed into office. And then right after it was installed, they started this barrage of attacks, to the point that CNN doesn't cover anything but Trump's latest tweets or ridiculous behavior. They wanted Mr. Trump to be in office because they wanted to sort of, Mr. Trump's rise to power was all about riding this populist wave, which temporarily satisfied the anti-establishment voters. They were on the verge of revolution after Trump. Especially the ones that are Caucasian, so-called Caucasians. They call this white backlash or some nonsense like that. It had nothing to do with race. Nothing. It's about the deep state taking over, and the deep state is comprised of basically traitors, whether they're black, brown, in this case orange. We have our first orange president, orange-colored president. Anyway, so the first schism was the firing of Trump's national security, or the resignation of Trump's national security, because he didn't declare some of his financial dealings with the Russians. And then you have this barrage of Russophobia with this neuro-linguistic programming of the Russian intervention in our elections. Five-word brainwashing, manipulating global public opinion. In communication studies, we call this strategic manipulation of perception. They repeat this five-word neurolingual programming phrase 1,000 times a day, all media except for Fox News. Thank God. I can't believe I'm saying thank God for Fox News. But MSNBC, the rest of them, CNN is the scummiest of them all. and trying to create this perception, this anti-Russia obsession, at mental illness level, anti-Russia, the hysteria, totally fueled by the news media. This is all part of the deep state. This is all part of the neo-lib arrangement of Obama. Obama put these ridiculous rumors before Trump even got to office, in office in early November. They started manipulating the public, this, what I call the strategic manipulation of perception. They started this weeks before this thing happened. It is totally irrelevant, totally irrelevant. Mr. Trump was supposed to be put into office not by Russians. It was supposed to be put into office by the deep state in order to satisfy, the crazy voters, which they were satisfied. Unfortunately, many of them don't have the complexities of understanding what's really happening right now. So they see the suppression, the firing of all these advisors as another, repression of Trump, and that Trump's standing strong. The whole thing is a scam. The whole thing is a scam. But unfortunately, that those 30% of the geniuses who voted for Mr. Trump, they can't put two and two together unless they watch Press TV and alternative media. Press TV at the helm, really. So then we have this role that was assigned to Trump's Zionist son-in-law, Jared Kushner, okay, who belongs to the liberal Zionist faction. And of course, there is a feud between the liberal Zionist faction and the conservative Zionist faction, which was headed, believe it or not, by Stephen Bannon, who calls himself alt-right or white nationalist, but these people are actually Zionist. Go figure that out. The Zionist actually being white nationalist, or this trend that's developing. Again, this was not a surprise to those of us who have studied history of the past 7 years or even 100 years, even since Madame Blavatsky. Zionism and Nazism were one and the same thing. Zionism is the most anti-Semitic ideology that has ever been concocted in human history. So people who don't understand these, I'm sorry, go back and study history or come to our lectures, enroll in our classes, and we'll open it up to you. But Stephen Bannon, whatever hell he was, conservative Zionist, alt-right, white nationalist, he created a perception of being a renegade, and perhaps he is a renegade, but he's being pushed out. So the battle that we're seeing is this upstart 35-year-old, little petty liberal Zionist, Jared Kushner, against the people that helped Trump get, elected or selected, whatever hell we want to call it, that are being pushed out. And the deep state completely taking over the populist wave. There's this crazy fly. Get out of here. All of whom, these populists, all of whom did vote for Trump, even though 20% of them were renegades from the left populist, and they voted for the independent Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders. Those were the figures that were given to us. 20% of his supporters were so disgusted that Bernie Sanders endorsed Hillary Clinton that they said, we're going to vote for Trump. So, which goes to say how stupid the Democratic Party usually is in selecting candidates that are going to lose. Again, there is no such thing as a Democrat or Republican Party. I call it the Republicrat Party. The whole thing is a farce. The whole thing is a farce. At any rate, we went to the 13-minute mark. I'm going to stop our taping here and create part 2 and 3 or 4 if it's necessary. Thank you for listening to our analysis. Stand by for part 2. Thank you.